Elia presents Talking. We're here to talk sports with my friend Tom Ngo. He is the ultimate hustler, an entrepreneur slash former music manager, an integral part of groups such as Jet Set, ISA, and 88 Rising, and more. He currently runs a podcast called Good Luck Glow Up and the director of content at Pop Shop Live. He's a sports enthusiast and a sports group chat commissioner of my sports group chat, Sports Haters Paradise. What's up, Tom?
What up, dude? How are you?
Oh, I'm doing all right.
Thanks for having me.
Of course, man. We're going to go straight into it. The NBA has restarted and the bubble is working. I think the NBA is smart. If you watch how the MLB, MLS, and everyone else has done, like, I think the NBA looks so good right now.
Yeah, man. What's his name? Adam Silver is just killing it.
Oh, amazing.
I feel like he does everything right. Like,
it sure seems like it. Everything from Donald Sterling, I think happened right when he started being a commissioner to here. It's just, he just seems to like nail it every time he steps up to the plate.
Yeah, I was surprised about the whole, how he handled that whole, the Sterling thing. I was really surprised. It was a good like first action.
I told Paul last week, and I'm wearing the Sonics jersey right now, when the Donald Sterling situation happened and Steve Ballmer bought the Clippers, I was like, we're getting the Sonics back. And then I saw the price tag and I was like, oh, no way he's moving the team. The value would go down so fast if he brought the Clippers to Seattle.
You think so?
Oh, absolutely. $2.2 billion. I did tell Paul that maybe way down the line it could happen. Like after he made his money and maybe, I don't know, like that could happen, but there's no way he would do that now.
I don't know, man. Maybe I'm just biased. I think the right move would be to move it to Seattle.
That's because you're a Laker fan.
No, I have a handful of friends like yourself in Seattle, and I feel like you guys deserve a sports team. I feel bad for the Clippers. Like I legitimately feel bad for them because they just don't have a home team. I get they make money, but it's like, I don't know.
Do you think there are legitimate Clipper fans? And what I mean by that is like from youth to adulthood, you're a Clipper fan. Are there people like that you've met from youth?
I feel like what Ballmer is doing now, you'll see it. But I think they need to win a championship before that happens. I think what he's doing is great. I think he's definitely trying to make it work. And he's doing a great job. I actually think he's doing a great job. You know, focusing on like family oriented, events and stuff instead of like trying to be like sexy, like the Lakers are, you know, cause Lakers already have that history.
Yeah.
But no, I really don't think so. Like all my friends that are Clipper fans that are like the hardcore ones, I feel like they did it out of spite, you know, or like they just didn't want to like go fall into the, you know, the Laker, like, oh, sure. Oh, everyone's a Laker fan, you know?
Sure.
And you know, I respect people like that. Like if they like go through years and years of just like, bad times.
Right.
You know?
Cause even Laker fans, like when you guys are bad, you're still diehards. There's some bad years and you guys are all still talking.
Yeah, we definitely are. I mean, if anything, those years were like more like growing pains for us. Like, I actually enjoyed watching those games, even though like it was really sad, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you just watch it and you're like, there's that hope, you know? And I feel like that's how you like truly become a fan, right? Is to watch them go through really bad.
I actually believe in that. I really do. I believe in that too.
Yeah.
Like, the Seahawks, for the longest time, just were. I mean, I can't believe we have bandwagon fans. I really can't. Like, it's just.
And that's part of being like a championship team, though. I tell my Warrior friends all the time, like they're always like, "Oh, why are you like hating on us? We've been like losers for so long." But I'm like, dude, that's just part of the.
That's true.
Being a champion.
That's true.
You know.
And also,
I'm happy for them. I'm so happy for my Warrior friends. You know that like finally they're like, you know.
Yeah. I think sports is one of the few things in life where you can completely talk smack to one another, but it's not personal.
Yeah.
Like, at all. Yeah. And you're constantly talking. Like, I mean, I personally don't like the Lakers.
Yeah.
Right? Because I grew up obviously hating them, but like, you know, like it's not anything to do with the person. Like,
yeah.
It's just sports.
Totally. So I mean, awesome. I hate Kevin Durant.
Do you really?
Pre-Warriors
Kevin Durant or post-Warriors Kevin Durant?
Warriors, like when he made the move, I just hated him. Like, that was like my, you know why, right? It's the whole like, if you're a hero long enough, like you become a villain. What's that quote, that two-faced Batman quote?
Yeah, if you live long enough you'll see yourself become the villain.
Yeah, so I was a huge Kevin Durant fan. I was like, F LeBron. LeBron is trash. Kevin Durant is the man. He's going to lead OKC. All this, you know? And then he goes to the Warriors, and I'm like, oh, my God. And then LeBron comes to the Lakers. It's so weird. It's really weird cheering for LeBron.
Oh, man. From episode one to episode two, this is like reverse. In a reverse, Paul hates Lakers.
Really?
Oh, I mean, I think it's because – and I was telling him this, you don't like other successful teams. I think, but that's also how you build rivalries. I think the Lakers is going to be amazing next year when it's back in full strength. And the Lakers are still title contenders. I had a opposite reaction to Kevin Durant leaving the Oklahoma City Thunder.
I was really
happy. But all my Laker friends said the exact same thing you did. Mm-hmm. And I also understand, probably because he did join the greatest regular season team of all time, and they eliminated the Thunder. So
I wanted him to go to DC. I remember thinking that very specifically.
Anything other than to do with the fact that he's from their area?
I always liked the home story. You know,
sure.
I thought it would have been cool if he went to Boston too. Like that would have been cool because they weren't great then.
Sure, they just have a lot of pieces that look.
Yeah, and I wanted him to go to a team where, like, he could kind of really flourish because I don't think OKC was just, like, you know, you can't build a team on a budget. I think that's what they've been kind of doing, you know? Sure. But, yeah, I really wanted him to go to, like, DC or, like – and I kind of give LeBron, like a run for his money. Wait, was LeBron yet there yet? No, yeah. Like, I wanted him to give LeBron, like, a run for his money in the East Coast, yeah.
I mean, those were fun. I mean, I guess it wasn't, I think it was 4-1, 4-0. So it wasn't extremely competitive. But Kyrie was only there one of the years. Kyrie bolted after that. So, all right. So today's August 1st for reference. So the Lakers are 1-1 in the bubble. How do you feel?
I mean, you're calling me right after a loss. So I'm going to feel like kind of sad.
So but, I looked up a few things before this meet, and one thing I did notice was you're playing 8 games in the bubble. You already played 2. You're 5.5 games up in the West. And there is no home court this year in the playoffs.
Yeah.
So it really only matters seeding purposes only for matchups, right? So no matter what, I think you'd rather play the 8th seed than the 7th seed. Mm-hmm. Because I think the 7th seed is probably going to end up being Dallas. And I think you'd rather play Memphis or Portland either way.
Yeah.
So unless you're planning on losing every game and the Clippers win every game going forward, I think you've locked it. I think you only need one more win to lock in the number one.
We need one more game, or the Clippers lose one more game.
Either or.
And everyone's saying that we don't want to see Portland. That's the news. That's the story right now because they have a full like roster. Like
Nurkic is back.
Is back, and then
Melo looks good.
Melo looks great. Melo looks amazing. You know. So I think they're going to be like a really dark horse 8th seed if they can get through.
To be honest, like if the seedings were different, cause like Utah is a little bit, I think it's a little shaky over there.
Yeah.
Obviously you know how I feel about OKC and Houston to me, I can't tell what they're doing.
Yeah. Like,
they seem to be the ultimate. We're not playing any defense and just run.
They're just scoring points.
Dude, and then like yesterday was the Mavericks Rockets game, and I couldn't believe the entire time Porzingis gets the ball with PJ Tucker on him. He never once goes down low, and I could not believe what I was watching. He was a foot taller than PJ.
But you know, PJ Tucker's big. Like he's like round.
Sure, he's stocky. He's stocky.
Yeah, he's strong.
Yeah.
Like Porzingis is not that. I don't think he's that strong.
I mean, in reverse though, if the Lakers play Houston, Anthony Davis is gonna murder PJ down low.
Yeah,
like that is that's just.
We have to play AD at the five if we want to win, though, for sure.
Yeah, I was watching Dwight and JaVale play today, and I was like, man,
that was terrible. I know
it's not looking great. And
yeah,
luckily, I mean, there's not a lot of teams where you have to play them very many minutes because everyone's playing small ball anyways.
Yeah.
So it's Do you have a team that you worry about the most? For playoff run, other than let's say the Clippers,
not really. But like Raptors look scary right now. Again, I mean, in a 7-game series we'd be fine, but we haven't beat them. Like they've beaten six us 11
years.
In a row.
Yeah, 6 years, 2014.
It's actually really crazy. Yeah,
I couldn't believe that stat when I saw it.
Yeah. It's actually really crazy. I think. Honestly, I actually think we're going to be okay. Like, I think
– Well, yeah.
I'm a little worried about Portland, no lie. Like, I think Dame is, like, one of my favorite players. I think he's so clutch.
So fun to watch.
Yeah. So, he's, like – I worry about him with a full, like, full team. But, no, I think, like, if we could – in a 7-game series, I actually think we'll be okay just because I feel we adjust really well.
Yeah. Yep. Any worry for the Bucks?
Not really.
Love it.
Not really.
I love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
I don't. Okay. This is a hot take.
I love it. Do it.
I don't believe in Giannis yet. I just don't. Like, I think he's great. I think he's awesome, but I don't know. I think he's just got to prove it to me first.
What if he's on a so I have this running joke again with Paul that Giannis is going to go to the Warriors.
I hope he doesn't.
Because that changes things, right?
I hope he doesn't. Yeah, I hope he doesn't. I think it'd be great if he stayed, but if he left, I wouldn't blame him.
I think if he loses this year, he leaves.
You think so?
I do. I really do.
I hope he doesn't. I really do.
I do really love him on the Bucks.
Yeah.
But I don't see it, man. Like, you notice all the supposed like superstars, they're leaving their teams earlier. Like Kevin Durant left the Thunder younger than LeBron left Cleveland. And I think Giannis will leave the Bucks younger than Kevin Durant left the Thunder if they don't win. I really do.
See, this is how I feel about the whole Kevin Durant leaving. I feel like Kevin Durant left because they didn't put around a good team around him, which is, you know, fair. I feel like this Bucks team is built for him. I feel like he is the reason why they haven't gotten far. Like, it's his fault if they can't, like, get to the finals. Last year, it was his fault.
The Thunder team that lost to the Warriors the year Kevin Durant left, right?
Yeah.
You don't think that team could have won a championship?
I think they could have.
They were one game away.
I think they could have. I wish he stayed. I wanted him to stay, but I get it. I really wanted him. No. I wish he did. I just wish he didn't go to the Warriors. I think it's the fact that he was game away.
Fair enough. Know? Yeah. Sure. I think in another world, he stays. Or I can't remember entirely how the recruiting process went, but I remember seeing like, it's not like Russ and them were like at his doorstep, like saying, hey man, come back. And I know that, what is it? Steph, Clay, Draymond, they all
Hamptons five. Yeah.
Yeah. So that had to play a part too.
I feel like him and what's his name? Westbrook just already didn't get along.
Yeah,
I think that was a big thing.
Yeah,
and I think I remember him saying that he wanted to be around more shooters and stuff too. I think that was a big
thing.
There was no shooters on that team.
Yeah,
the OKC team.
Yeah, Russell didn't suit Kevin Durant's.
That was the big thing. Both of them, like, they just didn't fit. I mean, him, the fact that the three of them, him, Durant, and Harden were all on the same team is actually crazy.
You know. That was supposed to be our team. That was supposed to be our team.
But, like, there was no way that team would have worked either because
no.
All three of them need the ball. And, like, you can't play all three of them in the starting line. And you can't have Harden off the bench. You can't do that.
Yeah.
You know? That was the year, pretty much.
I think they could have flipped Harden for a better package. Like, that was a terrible trade.
Yeah, who'd they get? They got, like,
They got Kevin Martin.
Yeah, that's right.
Jeremy Lamb.
Yeah.
And I think a draft pick or something.
His stock was low at that time, too, I think. That's why.
Yeah, yeah.
But they didn't realize how good he was.
We knew Harden was good, but I don't think anyone knew he was, like, MVP level.
Exactly.
So, speaking of lopsided trades, how is Pau Gasol trade? Is that not the most friendliest trade of all time that you guys got from Jerry West over in Memphis?
They got Marc Gasol.
That was a draft pick for Marc Gasol, and no one knew Marc Gasol was going to be good.
The Lakers did.
The Jerry Lakers West knew Marc Gasol was going to be good.
Yeah, that's why they drafted him.
So they got rid of Marc Gasol
because he wasn't ready. And they got – didn't they get – who they else they got? They got players.
Is that what you think?
I remember watching
that on ESPN in my college apartment going, what the I couldn't believe it.
I remember the exact moment. I was in China when that happened, actually. I remember the exact moment
Were you jumping up and down?
I was so happy. And, like, everyone around me didn't watch basketball, so, like, I tried to explain how big of a deal it was, and it was, like, really hard for me. I was so happy.
Oh, because he was great when he was in the Grizzlies too. So he's man.
That was a pretty lopsided. I mean, no, they got Marc Gasol. You can't say it's lopsided. They got Marc Gasol.
You're gonna defend this.
I'm going to defend it, and I know how wrong I am.
That's funny. All right, I gotta ask you this question. I asked you it a month ago, and I told Paul I was going to ask you because Paul's answer was the opposite of what your answer was a month ago. I just want to know if your answer is still the same. If the Lakers win the championship, are you going to the parade?
I probably will. I probably will. I know it sounds super irresponsible. I probably will.
I think you told me over text, like, you know, wear a mask, a face shield, like, whatever it is.
I'll probably buy, like, that's what I said. I don't know if it was you. I said I'd probably figure out a way to buy, like, a full, like, what do you call those, like, what are those, like, suits? Hazmat suits. Yeah.
For context, for people who don't know Tom well, like, Tom hasn't been going out and partying like some of you.
Yeah.
Like, he's still quarantined. He's social distancing. Like, this is how much the Lakers mean to him.
Yeah. Like, I'm pretty intense. Yeah, like, just so – yeah, that's actually good for context. I actually have not seen a lot of people. I've only seen, like
– yeah.
Yeah. I haven't seen anybody.
Very minimal. Really. Yeah, very
few. Very minimal. And I even, like, don't go home to my parents either and to see them either. So it's been, like – literally by myself.
And you live alone too.
I live alone too. Yeah.
Yeah.
My brother lives downstairs and I barely see him. And I wear a face mask when I go into his place and stuff too. So I've been taking it pretty serious.
Yeah. You're responsible. I mean, I mean,
I'm trying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's how much he loves the Lakers. What else?
That's how much I love the Lakers. Yeah. I will probably wear a hazmat suit and go.
If you go, will you go alone or will you go with people you know?
I feel like I have a group of friends that will, like, go with me. Like, I feel like there's definitely, I mean, it's been so long, 10 years now, so.
Oh, dude, all right, don't get me started. You know how many championships you see? Stop it.
It's true.
Stop it.
It's true. It's actually really true.
It's been so long. You know, we haven't had a team in 12 years.
Has it been 12 years?
Yeah, they left the year I started dating Stacey. That was the last year. 2007-2008 year was the last season we had in Seattle.
Kevin Durant's been in the league for that long too?
He got drafted in 2007. And Russell Westbrook got drafted in 2008. Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
So they drafted Westbrook and then they left. So Westbrook was
the Sonics
played for the Sonics. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. So there's two topics I want to go. I think one's quicker than the other, so I'm going to go with it. Is LeBron going to be the first NBA superstar to never participate in anything during All-Star Weekend?
Yeah.
I actually had to look this up. I was like, oh, wow. Everyone at least did a three-point, a dunk or something. LeBron's never done any.
Yeah.
Because it seems like that, unless he does, the three-point contest, which I think he might maybe one day do.
I don't think so. I feel like it's so calculated with him. Like, with him, he won't do it unless it's, like, a for sure thing.
Do you think that's a good thing?
Huh?
Like, because Michael Jordan's lost a dunk contest. I don't think anyone really cares.
So, okay. So this is where I think is the difference between him and, like, Kobe and LeBron. Okay. I mean, Kobe and Jordan.
Okay.
Like, I think every move he does is very calculated. If he doesn't look good or whatever, like, he really cares. Where Kobe and like Jordan is very like, I'm gonna put myself out there, win or lose. Like, I'm gonna put myself out there. Like,
I always thought MJ was pretty calculated. Like, the way he never got into political issues and all that stuff with business until LeBron came, and we even know LeBron's team by name. Like, I don't know who Kobe's team. I mean, I knew Rob Pelinka. That was his agent. You know, agent. But like, David Falk for Jordan. But like, LeBron, we know his manager, his agent, his right-hand man, like everything.
And I mean, he's like a brand. LeBron's like a brand. LeBron's, that's why I think the closest, like, comparison is Magic. You know, like Magic is like that guy. Like Magic, like you don't even know, like it's branding. You don't even know him as Irvin. You know him as Magic. Sure. You know what I mean?
Right.
And so like even him and his like Magic theaters and Magic, like all this stuff, you know, like he's like that brand. Magic is like the 80s version of LeBron. Like Magic would probably like excel in these times, you know?
I think so too. Magic, other than the one, you know, I don't know if I should call it a mishap of, you know, when he contracted HIV. He has a clean record. Yep. And LeBron has a completely clean record. We haven't seen anything on him.
Yeah, no, I get exactly what you're saying. Yeah.
Should the NBA get rid of tampering rules? I thought about asking you this. That's
a good question.
Because, you know, in all honesty, they're pretending to have tampering rules.
Yeah. Because
you know they talk. They hang out. They go on vacations together. Like
they do it because of like the smaller teams, I think. But you can't like, I mean, if you think about it, like, you know, Kawhi Leonard has a ton of Microsoft stock. Like Ballmer is so rich. Like Ballmer's rich. Like I had to look up his worth. I was like, oh my God, the top 10 owners, like the other 9, if you combine them,
it's not even Ballmer. Yeah.
Ballmer has way more money still. Yeah. It's insane. Yeah. You know? Yeah.
You can't help it. I have a, cause like there's loopholes behind it. And I don't know if you're going to defend this too, cause you're a Laker fan, but like, I thought the Staples Center getting Blaze Pizza the year before LeBron went there, that could be considered tampering if you want to call it tampering. Right. Like there's so many things, but I don't like, cause like all these players, there's all over the place now. And Paul George knew Kawhi was going to the Clippers before any of us did. Yeah. And he called up, you know, Sam Presti, like, should that be considered tampering? Like, I don't know, because
that was a bad trade, by the way.
For the Thunder?
Yeah. Oh, no. For the
Clippers. Clippers.
Yeah.
Really?
I think the Thunders robbed them.
The Thunder robbed them. That's a statement. The
Clippers, yeah. Dude, they got four or five picks. And SGA looks frigging good, dude. I mean, it worked for both teams. Like, Kawhi wouldn't have came without PG. You know what I mean? It's a big gamble for the Clippers.
I guess what the Thunder needs to do is, how do you pronounce his name?
I call it SGA.
Yeah. If he becomes even just a good player, if one of the entire draft picks hits, then I think the Thunder came out pretty good.
I think he's amazing already.
He is good.
I think I'm surprised. Like, I think that whole, like, combination of, like, CP3 and him is, like, kind of, like, really awesome, actually. I think he got put into, like, the best situation.
You think CP3 will be there for the entirety of his contract? You don't think they'll trade him?
Is that contract
untradeable?
Yeah, that contract is. How many more years does he have?
He has what? Three?
He just signed a new contract, right?
Yeah.
And then his contract is ridiculous, actually.
Yeah. It's crazy numbers. These super max contracts are crazy numbers.
Yeah. Like, you get stuck with them. Like, Jamal Murray has a really bad contract, too.
The Scottie Pippen, when he got paid after his bad deal, is like 2 years of CP3's contract. Like, it's like way up there now. It's insane.
I feel so bad for Pippen after I never knew that.
Man, I had an entire conversation with a childhood friend last Sunday. He was the biggest Jordan fan growing up. And he was like, I can't believe he did Pippen dirty. He just kept going on and on. It was, I mean, that's an entire topic in itself.
Yeah. I cheered for the Sonics, by the way. During
96?
That, in 96. I was like a Kemp, Gary Payton fan during that period. I like the underdogs. If it's not the Lakers, I like the underdogs. You know?
I love shoes, obviously. But there's one shoe I never bought, even if I could. And it's the shoe he's wearing when they won. When on the ground, like, it's a very popular shoe, the Bread Alert.
Yeah, but I think we talked about this.
Yeah, I can't do it. Like, it's just a bad childhood memory.
Yeah, like, yeah, for sure.
Terrible. Okay, speaking of childhood memories, I don't know if it's too early, but is it okay if we talk about Kobe a little bit and what he means to you?
Yeah, for sure.
So, there's just so many Kobes to talk about. What's your earliest Kobe memory?
His air balls.
Utah Jazz?
Yeah, oh. I remember that. Actually, you know what? Before that, I actually had, like, I don't even know where it's at. It's in my garage somewhere. I have the newspaper of him getting drafted.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Yeah. We did a trade, and I just remember I was in middle school or something, or elementary school. All I remember was them telling me, this is, like, the next Jordan.
Yeah.
And, like, that was his, like, running thing, and I think we had just gotten, like, you know, we had just gotten like Shaq and Phil Jackson and all that. And like everything was kind of like coming together. So that was
man, that Laker team. I really liked Eddie Jones a lot when I was a kid.
Oh, yeah. And it was a fun team.
And the Nick Van Exel was amazing. I remember it was the summer between fourth and fifth grade for me. And I was getting tutored by this guy who took taekwondo from my dad. And he was telling me about Kobe. He was the same age as Kobe.
Yeah.
And he was saying he made the NBA. I was like, what do you mean he made the NBA? He's like, yeah. And he was just telling me how good he was. And got me
that's crazy. Jordan.
He went to prom with Brandy. And I was like, what? Like, it was hard to conceptualize in my head as a 9-10-year-old.
Yeah.
But then, and then the Kobe All-Star game. The between the leg dunk.
Oh, yeah. That was huge. That was crazy. Yeah.
And I was just a huge Kobe fan when I was a kid. I remember imitating that behind the back move he did on Dikembe.
Yeah. I didn't know you were a big Kobe fan. That's cool.
Oh, when I was a little kid? Oh,
yeah. That's cool.
I have a lot of Kobe rookie cards because I used to collect basketball cards. And, yeah, I mean, before I understood, like, rooting for your home team, like, you watched I was a big Penny Hardaway fan.
Yeah.
Grant Hill. And then
I was a Penny Hardaway fan, too.
Yeah. I think, our age group, like, liked – and they probably marketed well the NBA.
Yeah.
Our generation. But, yeah, Kobe was just – I loved Kobe so much. And my dad rarely texts me, but he texted me the day Kobe died. I was in California. I was in Orange County.
Oh, wow.
I was at a wedding, and I was driving the car, and the passenger, my friend, screams. And I was driving a rental, so I was, like, worried.
Wow. I'm
turning into the parking lot, and he just says the words, Kobe's dead. And I was like, and my body went numb.
Yo, that's crazy.
Yeah, and then I parked the car, and I had to go on Twitter.
Yeah.
And obviously, at that point, everything was that. And I saw that I had, like, I think 11 missed text messages. And it was all the same thing.
Yeah.
And I walked into the restaurant. It was a taco shop. And this dude was crying. And I don't know, like, the fact that we were in California at the time. Our TSA agent.
Yeah.
He was, like, checking me. He was like, man, that was Kobe, dude. Like, he doesn't even know me. And we're just, it was just. And then, I think I just couldn't believe it. And then obviously his daughter too. And then we had our daughter with us and I couldn't cry in front of her.
Yeah.
So at the airport, I actually went into the bathroom to cry and come back.
Wow.
It was a tough thing to swallow.
Yeah. It's heavy, dude. Yeah. I actually was so surprised it affected me that much, to be honest.
It might've been the first person we've ever seen from the beginning of the career to the end that went this tragically for my age group, at least. Like,
I mean, there's only 3 NBA like Hall of Famers that have passed away.
What's the other one? Wilt?
It's Wilt, him, and like, is Moses Malone still alive?
No, I think yeah. Okay,
I think it's those three, like Hall of Famers, you know. And he's actually like a young one, you know?
Right, right.
So that's why it's like, I mean, yeah, it was crazy. I remember exactly when it happened, like just even like someone posted on my wall and I was like, get out of here.
Right.
And then I remember I had to really search because it was that early when I found out.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so even Twitter, there was like little bits, but nothing confirmed.
Because there was also errors. Like they say Rick Fox died and he didn't.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a crazy morning. I remember. It was like the day after Chinese New Year's too. I totally remember.
Yes, because I was there for a wedding and it was a Chinese bride. Mm-hmm. And I remember talking about that. Do you have a favorite Kobe memory?
Yeah, I do, but it's like sad.
Okay.
So
I was trying to change the mood.
Yeah. I mean, it's sad in like how you look at it, right? So okay. it's when we lost to Boston.
Okay.
I have it on my screen. It's my like favorite Kobe image, actually. I want to blow it up. It's when when we lost to the Boston Celtics in the 2008 finals.
Yeah.
And he's walking off of the court and there's this green confetti.
Yeah.
Coming out. Oh, yes. And my memory of that is just like, that dude just went back at it that night or whatever. And he just, you know, won back to back the following years, you know? So that for me was really inspirational. And I think the whole Kobe arc is actually like super, is an arc I really like. Cause like, I'm definitely more of a Shaq fan than I was a Kobe fan.
Really?
Yeah. So I was a Shaq fan more than a Kobe fan. So even when Shaq left, I was bummed out. And I was more of a Shaq fan for sure.
This is interesting because like I started going to LA as an adult after Shaq was already gone. Mm-hmm. So I've never really asked this. So like Shaq really owned LA at one point.
Yeah, I mean, Shaq was the man, dude. Shaq brought us back. Shaq won a back-to-back. Like I think Shaq is a very like humble person, I think. I actually do think that. I think like if it was anybody else, it would have been even more. Just because like Shaq like owned LA and like he could have, yeah. We just had two great stars at that time. It was actually really crazy.
Man, you guys always have two good stars. What are you talking about?
I know.
Spoiled. I have a Shaq story. When I was in sixth grade, we were playing, I can't remember if it was the first round or semifinals against the Lakers. And Shaq said something about George Karl in the papers. And I was talking a bunch of smack about Shaq at school, just in front of him, talking smack. And then all of a sudden someone goes, hey, Shaq is here. At our school. And I was like, what do you mean Shaq is here? So we had a kid, he was a year younger than me. His name was Austin Green. Mm-hmm. And he was AC Green's nephew.
Oh, wow.
And his mom was, I guess, dating Shaq at the time. Right?
What? Yeah.
Yeah, and all of a sudden, in the hallways, when I'm in my classroom, I see Shaq walking down the halls. And Shaq goes to Austin's room. He hangs out. He takes a picture with them. He goes to the gym. He leaves his size 22 shoe there. But that's the day crazy. We were talking smack about Shaq,
that's
he
funny.
Shows up at school. And I couldn't believe what was going on.
That's funny. That's so funny.
But he was gigantic. I could not believe a human was that big.
Yeah. I actually think Shaq's super underrated.
Oh, you know, it's both. Like, I actually think Shaq, I don't know if he could have accomplished more, but my dad used to always say, there's no way a person that big should be that coordinated to move like that. And I didn't understand that when I was little. But now that I'm older, I'm like, oh, wow, tall people are kind of like more, they are less coordinated.
He was fast.
Yes.
He was fast for a big guy.
Like people say Zion's big and fast. It's because of young. Like Shaq was.
Yeah.
If Shaq was in this era, he would kill.
That's what I tell people because they think he's slow. He's not slow.
No. Yeah. Maybe like Phoenix Suns, Boston Celtics Shaq was slow.
Yeah.
Orlando and LA Shaq, oh my God.
He was fast, yeah.
He would kill this league still. I think Shaq works in any era. I really do.
Yeah, he's just dominant.
Yes.
He's so dominant.
Other teams would have to adapt to his style because you can't stop him.
Yep.
And
except for free throws.
Yeah, but like at the same time, he shoots so many and free throws, the clock can run. That if the clock still goes while you shoot free throws, I think Shaq's a problem.
That's true. That's true.
It's just, yeah.
Yeah, you're just giving him points and stopping it. Yeah.
All right, dude. So I have so three kind of game segment. First one's called over or under.
Yep.
So I'm going to give you a topic and a number, and you tell me whether you think it's over or under. You don't have to tell me it by how much if you don't want to, okay?
Yeah.
So newest Laker, J.R. Smith.
Awesome.
He's in the bubble. He was doing an interview, and he said he only brought 7 underwears, and he thought one a day was enough, but he didn't think about the fact that he'd be practicing, he'd need a shower, golfing. So he's using 2-3 a day, and he said he underprepared his underwear, right?
Mm-hmm.
Over or under, if you were gonna be in the bubble for, let's say, 3 months, let's think optimistically, make it to the NBA Finals, 3 months, would you go 7 over or under?
Over.
By how much do you think?
If I played in the NBA and I know how much I sweat,
yeah,
I'd need like 2 or 3 a day, I think.
Sure, right? That would be the plausible
thing. Yeah, I would need 2 or 3 for sure. Because I sweat so much.
Yeah. Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah.
All right, man. So, Lemon Pepper Lou. I know you love that nickname. Lemon Pepper Lou. So, there was an article out by strippers from Magic City saying he was a good tipper.
Mm-hmm.
Over or under 30% tip?
I think he's over.
Over?
Yeah. Over. I like Lou Will a lot. That's why.
Dude, he's awesome.
Feels like a generous guy. I feel like he's a generous guy. I love him.
Yeah. He's cool. All right, Kobe and Shaq.
Mm-hmm.
Kobe won 5 rings. If Kobe and Shaq never broke up, over or under 5 rings?
Over.
Is there a number you want to stamp on that?
And this is like they worked out their
yes,
thing, right?
Sure.
So, like, to be honest, the main thing I think was like they worked out their thing and Shaq actually tried.
Okay.
Right. That's what we're saying, right?
Yeah. Well, because there's no way they would have stayed together if they didn't work it out. Like, there's no way. Like, someone would have got dealt.
No, I mean, yeah, so they have had to work out. Because, like, I think if they had been on the same page, they would have won 4 in a row.
The reason why I think would be over as well was the best team they had to go through was the Spurs.
Yeah.
Because, and they've beaten them, and the Spurs beat them the year before they went to Detroit, I think. And then the only team you would need to beat in the East for like a 3-4 year span is the Pistons or the Nets. Yeah. And I think you guys would have figured that out if Kobe and Shaq kept playing. So I think over as well.
Who won after Detroit?
Spurs. They beat Detroit. They beat Detroit. Okay. Yeah. And then
I think they would have won like 7.
7?
Yeah, I think they would have won 7.
Okay,
they were so good, and Kobe was barely coming on. I think if Shaq had just cared a little bit, he would have. Yeah. Wait, no.
If Shaq cared as much as Kobe,
he'd be
the best player of all time.
Oh, easy.
Like greatest player of all time.
Easy.
Yeah.
I think if he even just cared a little bit more, it would have changed everything. I think.
Yeah. That's probably what drove Kobe nuts. I think that's what he was saying in that one-on-one.
Yeah, when you're like, I think when you're trying really hard and the other person isn't trying hard, like you kind of get frustrated, you know? And then plus, like, you get the whole, like, Shaq is the man. Like, that's, I think, the main thing was, like, Shaq's the man.
Yeah.
But Kobe's trying so hard, you know?
It's odd because I always love Kobe more during it. I remember, I can't remember what game it was, but it was in Indiana. Shaq fouls out and Kobe takes over the game in the finals. And I just remember thinking, wow, I knew Shaq was awesome, but just Kobe was my guy.
Yeah.
Okay, so that leads into this or that. So I'm going to give you 2 scenarios and you pick this or that, okay? So Kobe and Shaq Lakers or Kobe and Powell Lakers?
Oh, that's tough. Kobe and Shaq.
Awesome. KG or Tim Duncan?
KG.
Is there a particular reason why? Is it because Tim Duncan's game is boring?
Tim Duncan's game is a little boring. I think Tim Duncan is... Like, if I had to pick, like, to start a team, I would pick KG over Tim Duncan. I think Tim Duncan was in a very good situation.
So you think if the roles were reversed, like the Spurs would have won as just as much, or if not more?
Yes. Yes. If not more with KG.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm not going to debate Michael, Kobe, or LeBron, but we both love watching the Last Dance documentary. Mm-hmm. Whose Last Dance documentary will be better, Kobe or LeBron?
Ooh. That's a good question. I would say Kobe just because there's more like drama.
You think
like there's more drama. Sure. I feel like with LeBron, he has put a lot of stuff out there already. Okay. That unless there's some secret thing that comes out, we don't know. Like Kobe, like I definitely want to know what happened in Colorado. You sure. know what I'm saying? Like sure. I want to know like that yeah. stuff. I want to know like sure. all the stuff that happened with the Phil Jackson book,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
The Shaq stuff, right? Even all like the little cool things I've heard, like him, like how Garnett almost came to the Lakers.
Right.
You know, that's like a crazy.
Or Chris fact, Paul.
Right? Or like Chris yeah. Paul trade happening, yeah. right? So there was just so many. I think, and even like, I think Kobe's the type where he's very direct. So you're just going to get very like cool video bites. Sure. I think with LeBron, he's very passive. You know, so you're just going to see a lot of passive, like...
Yeah, I don't know if LeBron would tell the truth.
That's really the other thing, too. Yeah.
Like, yeah. Actually, you know, I just thought of this now because you said Kobe. Over or under, in the Kobe Last Dance documentary, Smush Parker, 3 minutes. Over or under?
Under.
Under. Yeah. Is that little?
Is that a little bit? I think it's just like... I think it... Yeah.
That's funny. All right, so the last one I do is called Top 5 from Top 5 Dead or Alive that we always debate with rappers. Mm-hmm. Top 5 non-Laker players. I told you I was going to ask you this on Twitter.
Yeah.
So top 5.
Active?
What do you prefer? Active or any era?
I'll do active because it might be easier for me right
sure.
now. Because I have so many that I like. Active, Dame Lillard. Lou Williams. Shoot, who else do I like? Shoot, this is hard. Shoot, who do I like right now? I like Steven Adams for some reason.
Oh, I can see that.
I like Steven Adams
for some reason. I hate the Thunder, but I can see it.
Yeah, I like Steven Adams for some reason. I like, who else is there? I like Jimmy Butler a lot.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I like Jimmy Butler a lot. So that's 4, right?
Yeah.
And then, who else is there?
It's one more.
I'm going to pick a, I really like B.I. too, actually. I'm a B.I. fan.
Did that bum you out that you?
I was pretty sad. I was bummed, but it had to happen. I get it.
Sure. Yeah, you can't get. I mean, they're not gonna give away Anthony Davis. That at least getting him back. Yeah.
Yeah.
No. And I actually seeing him have success feels pretty good.
Like, yeah, I'm rooting for him. Like, I'm definitely like low key rooting for like the Pelicans a little bit, just because they're a fun team and they're young.
Is there any part of you seeing like D'Angelo Russell, Julius Randle, Brandon Ingram, like kind of thrive that if that Laker team just gave enough time that they could have became something?
Yeah. I think they're kind of all like that Nick Van Exel, Eddie Jones era. I kind of knew at the time too when I was going to the games, I was like, this is our like Eddie Jones. And like, so I was, I mean, but that era, they were way better too. They definitely were better. They made the playoffs and stuff too, you know?
But they're so young now. Like
all they were so young. They're still all young.
One and done players, the guys I mentioned. Yeah. So they were super young.
I mean, like D'Angelo's been around the league for a while. He's only like 23.
Yeah, they're young. They're
BI's young. 21 barely. He just turned 21 or he's 20. Yeah.
They're just
they're kids, dude. Yeah. But I really like that team. So they were really fun to watch. They were like to be honest, the Laker games now, I honestly barely watch them. Like it's a very like, oh, we're gonna win. So I'm going to watch like
this. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And that's how I was with like the Powell and Kobe era. When we started winning a lot, I was like, oh, we're going to win. Like.
Man, spoken like a true Laker fan.
Yeah. Very, very, very Laker. Yeah.
Yeah. So I got two more for the top five. Kobe won 5 championships.
Yep.
From favorite to, I mean, obviously they're all you love. Favorite to least favorite, rank the 5
rings. Oh, wow. That's a good one too. I think my favorite one is the 2010.
The Boston Celtics?
One. The Boston Celtics one. I like that one. I like the story. I love story arcs. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Which is why I'm so disappointed in Kevin Durant. That's why. the only way I would become a Kevin Durant fan again, I think, is if he brings the Sonics back to Seattle.
Yes.
And he wins a chip for Seattle.
Yes. I am for this. I am for this. Yes.
Yeah. Because like that's how I felt about LeBron.
Yeah.
I only consider LeBron with 1 championship, and that was the Cleveland one.
What?
Yeah. The Heat's one? Come on.
What?
Get out of here. Okay, so 2010, 2001, right, that one, right? Then I would say like the three-peat one was really good.
Okay.
I like that one. And then which one was the one? The second one, the back-to-back one was really good. The who did we play?
The second championship?
Yeah, the second championship.
Philly,
yeah. Philly. I like that one, too.
Yeah.
That one was the one where we, like, that one was a good one.
You lost game one.
We lost game one.
And then you won 4 in a row, right?
Yeah, That was like, oh, you guys were lazy. Or, like, AI just went off.
Allen Iverson steps over Tyronn Lue and
AI is so good.
He was.
If he was 6'6", he would be, like, the best player.
Oh, my God.
Now.
He would have destroyed. I mean, he already did destroy the league.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So then, those 3, and then
you got the and Pacers then, and the
what, and then the two, Magic. The Magic one, and then the Pacer one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I like it. I love it.
Yeah.
So I mean, obviously, by your list, well, some of it had to do with the Celtics, because like watching them lose to Boston,
and I like then
going back and beating them. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is selfish of me, but what I would have loved to see if I could rewrite history was instead of you playing the Magic in the between Celtics year, play Cleveland. Like I would
that
have
loved been, to see LeBron. That would have been great. Play.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or play Boston all 3 years in a row.
Yeah.
It was that was awesome. All right. And then the last one, top 5, is not basketball related, or it could be top 5 live events that you've been to. I know you've been to so many.
Oh, that's good. That's a really good one too.
No particular order. No particular order.
Okay. This one. Shoot. This is a really good one.
Yeah, because you've been to so many. Like we talk.
Jay-Z concert.
Which one?
I went to his Blueprint 3 concert.
Oh,
that was my first.
Love that one.
First Jay-Z concert.
Me too.
Didn't understand the Jay-Z. I'm a very West Coast guy, so I'm like a little slow on the East Coast rap.
Oh my God, dude.
I didn't get the hype till that show. Oh, I was like, whoa, Jay-Z's tied.
You didn't know that until Blueprint 3?
No, I mean, I liked him, but I didn't realize, like, I think he's one of those guys that he's way better live.
He's way better live.
So Jay-Z is like, I mean, I went to his like the Jay-Z JT concert. He outperformed JT too, and I thought that was crazy.
I missed that one. Did he really? That's
Jay-Z is just an amazing performer.
He is. Yeah. And at the end of this top 5, I owe you an apology, and I'll tell you why in a second. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So Jay-Z,
Blueprint 3,
love.
2010 EDC, the rave, it was like my second rave I went to.
Okay.
That was just memorable because it got shut down, or like all the stuff was happening, and it was the last LA rave. So that was really like cool. Like that was part of it. And I was in a safe space. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so that was really fun. And then what else was there? The first ISA I did was really great for me.
What year is the first?
It's my own concert, so it was really great. 2008. I want to say 2008.
Okay.
2008, 2007. That was the first like YouTube concert too. Like there wasn't anything like that. And I remember that's when people started doing these events, like these YouTube events and stuff.
Got it.
I would say that was like the very first one. And I remember Yeah, I remember that. I thought that was really cool, and I had just gotten surgery the day before, and so I hosted the whole thing with like a bandage on my face.
Oh my god.
Yeah, that was crazy, and I was bleeding like throughout the whole show. But I just remember that because I feel like that kind of like that was like my like it was a little spark in history, you know?
Yeah, yeah. That's three,
and then yeah. Kanye Glow in the Dark.
Oh, that one was a good one.
That was
actually Stacey and my first concert together.
Oh, wow. Yeah. That was a great, great concert.
Yes, it was.
All the acts were amazing, right?
Dude, it was, yeah, Lupe, Rihanna, N.E.R.D., and Kanye.
Yeah, that was a great lineup.
You can't have a lineup like that.
You know who opened in L.A.? There was another opener for them. J. Cole opened for them.
Oh, my. J. Cole opened the Blueprint 3 for us. Did he do that for you guys, too?
I don't know. Actually, I don't remember.
We had J. Cole for Blueprint.
But J. Cole's an amazing performer.
Wallet. Yeah. This is so early in J. Cole's career that I was shouting and he spoke back. There was no one in the arena.
Dang, that's crazy.
It was a long time ago. So that's four.
Yeah, and I'm trying to think of one. I want to say like a Laker game, but there hasn't been a Laker game I've been to where that was like super crazy. I've been to a lot of like buzzer beater
games. Did you not go to Kobe's last game?
I didn't.
Oh, that's all right. Never mind.
I sold your tickets. I sold my seats. That was a weird game. That was a weird game. Like,
do you regret it?
Yeah. Looking back now, yes, knowing. But at that time, even that game, I was like, nah, I'm okay. Just because
they were ridiculous.
I made a lot of money off that.
Yeah.
Dang, I can't think of a Laker game, but I think like I went to a soccer game that was really cool in Mexico. Game. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And I'm not even like a soccer fan. The experience was just like another level.
I think if you go to the right games in the right environment, like I know the MLS is not incredibly popular, but going to a Sounders game is ridiculous.
Oh, really?
Oh, dude, the Sounders games, we get like 60,000 people.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And they have the drums and the chanting. It's
the energy is different. Yeah. That game was really memorable because it was in Mexico City. We bought bootleg tickets from like some random person because the person didn't buy tickets ahead of time. And so we got snuck in with like a fake Mexican ID. And then like we got walked into like the fan area. And the fan, they were telling us not to walk to the restroom by ourselves because we could get jumped. Like, the fans were separated.
What year is this?
It was like a rush. This was last year. This was like a year or 2 years ago. The fans were so, like, crazy intense that fights would happen. And then at the end of the game, when we walked out, there was just a row of, like, federales, like, watching us. Like, we were, it was just the weirdest experience ever. It was really memorable, like. I don't even follow soccer like that much, but it was just a fun experience and rained. Right. And so, yeah, it was fun.
That's awesome. Oh, wow. Okay. What a way to end it.
Yeah. I mean, I love events. Great. I think like live events is just everything.
Oh, absolutely. Man,
I have one more. Can I have one more?
Sure.
And I'll tell you the story too, because when I tell people the story, everyone doesn't believe me and they think I'm ridiculous. Snoop and Dre at Coachella. 2012, I think.
This leads perfectly into my apology. Go explain it.
That was such an amazing concert because I'm a big West Coast fan. I love like Snoop. I love Dre. I love the whole culture. I love Tupac. So I essentially was like to my friends, we have to wait in front. We were like near Rihanna. That's how like where we're at. I was like, I want to wait here. And we waited like 2 hours before everyone even came up. So it was like dead. And so we just waited there. And there was a ton of people that did too, because I wanted to see them so bad. We were so close that I didn't. So at Coachella on the main stage, most of the time you're not close enough. So you're just watching on the screens. Like
the big screens,
right? Yeah. So everyone at home, they're watching on the screens too. So I was so close, I didn't need to watch the screens. I'm just watching the person.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. So close enough. Right in the middle of the right in front of the sound booth. So I was like, best sound, everything. When Tupac's hologram came out, I thought Tupac was alive.
Oh, it looked that real.
Yeah, because he came out of the
Wow.
The thing. And I was far enough where I could see, but like not far enough where like I realized it was a hologram.
Sure.
So when he came up, like,
I wonder how trippy that was for people.
It was, because the people around us were quiet. We were like, so my headspace was like, wait, did they hire an impersonator? No. My first thing was, oh my God, Tupac's alive. I remember that. I was like,
how incredible would that have been if that's how Tupac revealed he was alive?
That's what I'm saying. So at that time, I was like, obviously drunk as hell. I was like, oh my God, guys, Tupac's alive. And then like 10 seconds later, I'm like, oh my God, they hired someone to impersonate Tupac. Because at that time in LA, there was a Tupac impersonator performing at clubs. So it was in my head, like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
that's interesting that he's at some Elvis kind of MJ level that people will do that. That's crazy. Yeah.
So then I was like, oh, they hired an impersonator. So I was like, what the hell? And then I looked on the screen and I was like, oh shoot, it's a hologram. And that was the first time we've ever seen a hologram like that too, you know?
Right.
So that was just like insane. But yeah, that was actually a really amazing moment.
Man, that's, I remember watching that, the stream. So my apology, and I'll end on this note, is was it a week ago when Snoop and DMX did Verses? Mm-hmm. And you wrote a tweet, and I didn't reply to the tweet. This is how I thought. So I'm owing you an apology for not even something I said, for feeling this way. Because I'm a big DMX fan. I'm a huge DMX fan. And I respect the hell out of Snoop. But I remember you said something along the lines of like, this is disrespectful to Snoop. He's a legend. Something like that, right? I don't remember verbatim what you wrote, but you wrote something along the lines of that. And I was like, what? In my head, I was like, DMX's catalog is incredible. And then I watched the verses. And I still think DMX's catalog is incredible. But Snoop, he's special.
Yeah.
Yes.
Let me bring something. That's funny that you brought that up, because that's exactly how I felt. I was like, this is disrespectful. But watching the verses, I was like, yo, DMX has hits. Like, I forgot. Like, I forgot how much of a big DMX fan I was.
This is why I actually love the verses, too. Yeah. It's like, I forget the entire, and they're not even playing everything. I think you wrote, like, Snoop left out so much.
Yeah.
And seeing, and you were saying how good of a performer Jay-Z is, and I think Snoop, too, is just so good.
Yeah.
So good. And watching him do DMX's ad libs and going up and down, I was like, wow, I don't know if I know very many rappers who can big up the other guy while still being confident in his own catalog.
He set that pace of that whole
It would not have been good without Snoop. It just wouldn't have.
He set that pace.
Incredible. I enjoyed it so much. And I have friends who never watched any of the verses. And that was the first one. They're like, what is this? And I was like, dude, I told you to watch when Luda played Nelly and, you know, 112 Jagged Edge. Some of them, you know, because of technical difficulties.
I was surprised. Wait, who won? Luda won. Like, that was the thing,
I think Luda destroyed Nelly.
I was surprised. I thought Nelly would have won. I was like a bit on the Nelly side.
Me too. Me too. Going into, I've actually been wrong more times than any other prediction I've ever had. Because I was like, Nelly got hits. And I was watching Luda, and Luda came out.
Yeah,
and
Luda has hits too.
And he revealed things that the public never knew, like Nelly was supposed to be on Moneymaker, and the label didn't clear it. And he played that version.
Oh, and that's crazy.
But I owe you an apology. You know, I love West Coast rap. Like, I discovered it actually after East Coast rap, which is funny, because I live on the West Coast.
That's interesting.
But, because when I got into rap, Puffy ran the scene. Puffy ran the scene, right? And then Jay-Z was just coming up. He had Hard Knock Life Volume 2.
Interesting.
So I was buying all the Bad Boy albums and then the Jay-Z albums. And then knowing that Biggie beef with Pac, I listened to Pac. And then I saw that Pac was on Death Row. And then I bought all the Death Row catalog and went to Dre, Snoop, and everything.
That's interesting.
I worked backwards like that. Because like when they were out, I didn't speak English. So I didn't do it. And then it just worked in that way. And so, which is weird, because like that beef made me introduced to Tupac.
My story is weird, because I listened to Tupac and Bone Thugs, but not really. Like, they just, like, when I was kids, they just played it.
Yeah.
And so we were just fans of Tupac and Bone Thugs because of like culture, not really because of the music.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
Sure. Yeah.
And then I really didn't get into music. And I listened to Puff and stuff, but it was never like I was like a Puff fan or anything like that. Like, I think
which is interesting
because
you were like kind of mirroring Puff to me.
Yeah. I mean, that was the goal. That was what I wanted to be, you know, like as I grew older.
Yeah.
I think Eminem was really my first like, all right, I'm a hip hop.
Really? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I mean, Eminem came out when I was like 13. So
yeah, Eminem was when I was like, all right, I'm going to be like a hip, like that's when I was like, I could go and talk conversations. Like I have so many relationships with friends now because of my like hip hop conversations.
Yeah.
Where I'm like, oh yeah, like, you know, blah, 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 blah. Like I just know more history. And it was because of Eminem for sure.
Yeah. I think music, sports, and whatever you're passionate into kind of makes it easier to make friends too. I became friends with people because in college they'll be like, oh, you rap, this person raps, and they'll introduce us and stuff like that too. When we hoop, you see people at the gym all the time, and then, you know, they're like, oh, you're into shoes too. So like,
yeah,
it's a cool thing, which is why I love sports, to be honest, because even when I don't necessarily agree with the team, we still are passionate about the sport.
Yeah.
I do love that a lot. I purposely left out NFL today because I didn't think there was enough NFL topics to talk about, to be honest.
And I'm not super great at NFL. I'm still learning. Like, I'm actually like, and just so you know, I'm actually a Raiders fan, so I know about losing. So, but yeah, I'm actually pretty new to sports. Like, it's only been a couple of years. Like, I followed the Lakers just like culturally and stuff, you know, but like really, really getting into sports has been like the last six, seven years.
That's just so interesting because you live in a city that's just so spoiled with.
Yeah, it totally is, you know, and like, so I was always like more of a passive fan and everything. But now it's like, I think I've built so many cool relationships that I'm just like, it's hard not to be into sports, you know, like, and I like love sports because of that reason. Like, I have so much cool friendships because of it.
Yeah. I thank you, Tom, for joining us. Thank you so much. Bring the Sonics back.
Yeah.
I told Paul at some point we're going to have to do like a group, like LeBron, HBO, the shop type of thing.
Down.
People. Yeah. So I'll get enough people who like different teams so we can actually talk some smack to one another.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
All right.
Yeah. Thanks for having me, man.
Of course, man.